life is like way too short to drink bad wine, warm beer, especially if you're a margarita chick like I am. So this video is all about some tips for those of you that are getting on in age. If you're curious, stay tuned. I was cruising Facebook and I saw this post by a gentleman named Mark Snyder. Now, I don't know who Mark Snyder is. I have absolutely no clue who he is or what his gig is, but he had a post that was tips for those over 65. It was living your best life over 65. And I read it. He had like 21 tips and they were quite in depth. If I have room, I'll copy them below. But I read it and I was like, wow, it just kind of resonated with me. And I totally agreed with some of his points and didn't on others. Anyways, one of my Facebook friends is Babs, who has a channel here on YouTube, Take Control Beauty. And we were chatting and I brought up the post, and at the same time she had already seen it as well. And we started to really talk about his post and our thoughts on it. And I said, whoa, wouldn't it be kind of cool if we did sort of a collab with each other? She's got like 10 years on me. And I was really curious to see what her take was on the tips that he shared. Now, if you don't know Babs, I will definitely link all her information below. But if you don't know Babs, you are totally missing out. She is an incredible woman. I think she's 78. She has lived a life that's had some challenges for sure. I know both her and her husband Denny have lived through COVID. She has a family, she has grandkids. She's got a pretty well-rounded life. And I swear, when you look at her, she looks at least 20, maybe even 30 years younger than 78. I was like, holy mackerel. So I've watched her videos for a while. She talks about skincare. She does a lot of wig reviews. She's just really well-rounded. And I totally marvel at how her personality just simply resonates through her camera. I am in awe of her. I truly am. She is absolutely beautiful. But more importantly, she has, at 78, she has the most amazing attitude. She is spunky, vivacious, and yeah, I mean, I think she's just amazing. I want to be her when I'm 78. So anyways, we were chatting and we decided we're going to do this collab. I have no idea what she's going to talk about as far as Mark Snyder's original post. I will tell you that I am not going to address all 21 of his points. Some of his points that I agree spot on with, I will certainly talk about, and others that I have added onto this myself. So yeah, you know what? Life is too short, right? For bad wine, warm beer, and no margaritas. So anyways, first, my number one tip or point for living your best life ever. And he has 65, and I'm just going to say after your 60s. I mean, this can apply to anyone, no matter how old you are. I don't care if you're in your 20s. You know, this certainly applies to you. Now, of course, with age comes wisdom, and I can look back at my past, and I can look back at my mistakes, and I can reflect on life a lot easier than when I was going through life's challenges, when I was raising kids, when I was going through a divorce, when I was trying to carve out a career, all of that, you know, so I can look back on that. But my number one tip, and this is I have learned all my life, is that it comes down to your attitude. Your attitude is huge. Every night before I go to sleep, now I listen to podcasts in bed, but before I go to sleep, when I shut it off and I'm just ready to sleep, my eyes are closed and I'm in that lull moment, I think back on my day. And I think back on my day, I just reflect on it and I think about what are the three things that I just really strive for three. If you can't come up with three, if you come up with more, more power to you. But I think about what are the three things that I did, or that happened to me, or something today that I'm happy about, that I was happy happened, that I was proud of the way I handled it. You know, three things that can be a blessing, but three things that impacted me positively during the day. I mean, life many times gets way out of control, so I do think it's super, super important that we work on our attitude foremost. So I go to sleep thinking about those three things. Now, when I wake up in the morning, I have to start with a little bit of self-talk. I sometimes remind myself about the good things that happened the day before, but more importantly, before I even roll out of bed, I start to exercise my smile muscles. Now, granted, I'm a smiley person, so a smile comes more natural to me than it might to somebody else, but I am a smiley person, and I do like smiling, and I think, personally, I think nothing makes someone look old than if they are walking around with a frown on their face all the time. I really do. I think that it ages you and all of that. I think when you smile and you work those smile muscles, not only will you look better, you'll be more friendly appearing, you'll be more inviting, you will feel better. I know I do. And you also sound better. Like when I used to teach new agents, when they answered the phone, have a mirror in front of you and smile before you picked up the phone. Because when you answered the phone, and you, if you just had a frown on your face, your voice sounded different than if you had a smile. And I'm not saying ooh, ooh, ooh type of thing, but just uplifting, you know, just put that smile on your face. And sorry, I do have to go down and look at my notes a little bit. But, and it comes down to, you know, working my routine, being me when I get out of bed. So I'm exercising that smile, and then when I get out of bed, you know, I am going to be starting to do some of my skincare. I don't really care. It doesn't matter. I'm going to do the routine that I do every morning, and that can be skincare. It can be anything that I normally do in the morning, but most importantly, and when I do that, I feel proud. I feel proud that I've combed my hair, brushed my teeth, put clothes on, whatever, you know. And I do the self-talk, and I feel proud of what I accomplished yesterday. And you know, when I'm proud and I have that sense of pride, I carry myself better. I stand up straighter. So, you know, don't do things just because you're old, or don't do things that you always used to do that made you feel good. If you go to the hairdresser, go have your nails done if that what floats your boat. Go to the dermatologist. You know, obviously have your teeth taken care of. I've spent a ton of money with the dentist, and I'm not done yet. But if you are as well maintained on the outside and you come across as well maintained on the outside, then it's going to seep in and it is going to start to resonate, I think, from within. So attitude is, in my opinion, everything. Sit up straight, walk straight, have a good posture. You know, and that brings me to number two, activity. Yeah, activity. I think being active is probably the biggest tip anyone can have if you are getting on in years. Granted, it's harder to go up and down the stairs, and I have a very physical job in that sense. I show houses, so I do have to go up and down the stairs. But in general, moderate activity every day. Make an effort to go outside, take a walk, go out and just breathe the fresh air. I sometimes just walk around my backyard. It doesn't matter where I go, as long as I'm moving. Now, I have an Apple Watch. Not everyone wants an Apple Watch, but there are all sorts of different fitness trackers that you can get, and they are really inexpensive, and some are very expensive. But get some sort of a tracker that can track your activity. It can tell you, you know, when, mine reminds me, Monika, take a deep breath. It can sense maybe when I'm stressed, take a deep breath. Tells me to get up and walk around. How many calories I've burned, how long have I been moving, you know, how long have I been sitting, and stuff like that. So active. I mean, I really think that you know, the old-fashioned way of burning fat, which is simply taking a walk, absolutely works. You know, yes, of course, calories in, which I have way too many of, and calories out, you burn off by activity, which I have to work a little bit harder on. But yeah, age definitely slows us down. Age gives us grayer hair in most cases. It'll give us wrinkles. It'll slow us down for sure, and it'll give us posture issues, especially if you're always over a computer, you're slouched in a chair, it'll give you posture issues. So, you know, you do all sorts of things, I think, to take care of yourself. And it just comes down to being as active as you possibly can. And that activity also includes your mind. Keep your mind engaged. Keep your mind active. Stay up to date in what's going on in the world. If it's news, I mean, granted, you know, during the last 2 years, I didn't want to hear the news. I didn't want to see anything. I was sick of COVID. I was sick of politicians. I was sick of everything that was going on. But I still stayed up to date and as current as I could. I still wanted to engage my mind. I did more reading. I did more listening to podcasts. But, you know, I did. I checked out the online newspapers and I have a, on my iPad at night, I have a, like the Flipboard, which has, creates all the news that I'm interested in. So, yeah, do something like that. And third, to me, is all about love. Doesn't matter how old you are, keep love alive. You know, in my opinion, love your partner. If you don't have a partner, if you no longer have a partner, work on simply loving life. Love your family, you know, your friends. Spend time with them. It really costs you nothing to spend time with family and friends. And I also think that when you surround yourself with younger people, especially children, and their happiness, their joy is infectious, I think. You listen to a little kid laugh, a little child laugh, and you start to laugh, at least I do. So surround yourself with younger people, whether it's, you know, if you don't have any grandkids or any young kids in your life, you volunteer and be surrounded. You know, volunteer in a school system. My job involves a lot of younger adults. You know, I train new agents who are just starting out in their profession, and I work with first-time homebuyers as well, and they're all younger people. So I do surround myself, and I am like a sponge when I'm around people. I watch what they're saying, and I listen to their words, but I watch how they say it, and I probably read more into their facial expressions than anything, which is probably a good or a bad thing, I don't know, but I could mourn the passage of time, but I don't. I look at them and I go, wow, you know, I was there once and now I'm helping them shape their career, and it's so rewarding. And it keeps me, I think, acting younger to a certain degree. I'm more aware of the different styles and things of that nature, but I am very much like a sponge, and their attitudes and the things that go on around my life, I can absorb, and then I can adjust to my own level of comfort. Number four, this one I debated about, stress and toxic people. So I do believe, and I have often said this, you are who you surround yourself with. If you let toxic people, negativity come in, you will be toxic and you will be negative. So I keep toxic people, negativity, away from my inner circle. I know many people out there that are negative. I know people that are toxic, but they're not in my inner circle. I don't spend hours with them. If I did spend hours with toxic, negative people, I would just be bitter and toxic and negative myself. So I don't want to do that. I avoid that. A friend of mine in real estate, her and I have been going back and forth. She's the exact same age. We both started our careers at the same time. And there was an issue that had gone on. And we were talking about it. And we were talking about, wow, you know, it's amazing. She sent me this article that she had, I don't know from who, but it was about in the horse dressing or dressage industry, you know, when they show horses, they have the trainers and all that. And the article was The Toxic Barn. And I was like, yeah, you know, and in that article, there were so many good points for avoiding toxic people and also what toxic people can do to you, can make you look at life in that negative way. I thought it was fantastic. So, you know, yeah, avoid them. Avoid toxic people. They're in all walks of life. They're in real estate. They're in the horse business. They're in every business. They're certainly in the, you know, YouTube world. So they're there everywhere, and avoid them. And, you know, learn from your past, obviously. But don't let your past mistakes, don't let your past regrets drag you down into the pit, because you know, you have to go forward. You have to put them behind you. You have to go next. I do that all the time. Okay, I learned. Next, right? I trusted this person. I'm trustworthy. Next. So don't let the future ever frighten you, and don't let the past ever drag you down. The future is right now. What you're living is your future right now. So the next one is dress your age, or not so much. I don't know if you can really see this top I have on, but I have these like big bell sleeves. And I consider this like a Stevie Nicks top, you know, with Stevie Nicks, and she'd come out and she'd prance around the stage, and she always had these big sleeves, and I love Stevie Nicks. So dress your age or not, as I say. Don't lose sight of the fashion, right? I mean, keep your eye on what's going on the trends and all that, but there are some trends that are not going to look good on me no matter what. So keep your own sense of style. I try to do that. And there's nothing worse, in my opinion, than seeing an older woman or man trying to dress in a younger style that doesn't become them, that just does not become them. I know enough that with my fat, chunky legs, I'm not going to wear white pants because it's just going to look like I have craters all over the place. I don't look good in white pants. It makes me look bigger. So, I'm just, you know, after the course of time, I've developed my own style. I'm comfortable in my own style. If I want to wear earrings that I wore when I was a teenager, I actually found my diary. My diary from 1968. I talked about this. Look at this, Joe and Monty, Nick. I talked about this diary in one of my videos that I did quite a while ago. I have notes in here. I have pages in here. This is a diary from 1968. When I found that diary, I also found one of those small little hope chests, and I had all my old jewelry in it. And so, yeah, your sense of style. These are earrings that I've had probably since I was, I don't know, 14, 16, 18. And here I am, 67. And I'm wearing them. I don't really care. We all have developed our own sense of style. I still wear black eyeliner. I know it's not age appropriate. I'm told often it's not age appropriate. My eyebrows are more natural instead of having the brows built up. But that's my comfort zone. That's how I feel the best. So the next one is forgiveness and resentment. And you know, we've all been there, right? I mean, we've all had things happen to us. Perhaps someone really offended us. Perhaps someone really hurt our feelings. It could have been a spouse. It could have been a family member, coworker. It doesn't matter who or what. But forgiveness is the hardest thing, I think, to really forgive someone. So work on forgiveness. And my goodness, if you've offended someone, if you said something that you shouldn't have said, or you think back on, geez, I shouldn't have done that, go ahead and apologize. Just say, you know what, I'm thinking about what I said last month, last week. I really feel bad about that. I shouldn't have said it that way. And here's what I really meant. I am so sorry if I offended you. I am so sorry. Say the words. If you let the, if you let resentment stick with you, and it's just going to be dragging you down. And I think Mark Snyder said in his, and I'm going to read it, because on his he said, holding a grudge is like taking poison and expecting the other person to die. So you hold a grudge, right? And you're bitter, angry, or whatever. It's like taking poison yourself and you expect the other person to die. No, it doesn't work that way. Uh-uh. So don't take that poison. Forgive, forget, and move on with your life. Absolutely. And then the next one for me is compromise. I'm really worried how long this video is getting. Compromise. If you're in a relationship, and I have another video coming up on marriage. But anyways, if you are in a relationship, learn to compromise. Compromise on activities. Compromise on the time apart you have. You know, where, you know, my husband's a golfer. I respect and encourage him to golf to a certain degree. Do I want him golfing every single day? No. But I respect that's his passion, that he loves it. So encourage hobbies, encourage time apart, because if you have time apart, your relationship will be stronger. So we always make time for each other. We always make time for each other. And we work very strongly on when we do compromise, when we do something we both want, or we're going to, I compromise and do something he wants, he compromises and does something I want. We make a point of being totally engaged in it. I mean, put the devices down. Don't check your email. Don't check your voicemail as much as possible. And engage with each other. And for us, it can be a simple thing like taking a walk or a ride up the coast. We love doing that. And we have together time. It keeps us connected. It keeps us in tune with each other. He respects that I have a life. I respect that he has a life. And together we are a couple. And we maximize that togetherness as much as possible. And I think because we respect the other activities we each have, I think that makes us a stronger unit. So compromise. Live smart. Spend money. Nah. Live smart. Spend your money. You know, I always say, because I have worked hard all my life and I don't have money, you know, like crazy. I'm not rich by any stretch. But I do enjoy the money I've earned. I do when we can go on trips. I enjoy my camping. I enjoy a lot of things because I know that tomorrow is not going to be guaranteed no matter what. It could end today, right? It could end today. But you should have some sort of a plan for tomorrow. I'm planning on being here tomorrow. So I'm sort of having a plan, a cushion for tomorrow because I want to be as independent as possible for as long as possible with Jay and I. So I am going to spend my money, but I also want to have that safety cushion. I don't owe it to my kids to save it for them, right? I am living in the moment in many ways, but I want to make sure that I do have that cushion for tomorrow and that I can be comfortable and independent for as long as possible. And then lastly, it's say those words, you know, tell your children, tell your spouse, tell your family, friends. Tell them you love them. Say the words, I love you. I wish I had said those words more to my father. But say those words and give them memories. Make memories. Take pictures. Take videos. Document your life as much as possible. You know, keep a journal. Keep a life journal. But those moments that you are creating and you're sharing for your kids and your grandkids, someday your grandkids will be watching or reading those things that you wrote in your journal. And it's a legacy that you leave behind so they can actually, I would give anything if I could know what was going on in the mind of my great-grandmother. You know, I would give anything if I could understand them a little bit better. And I so wish that there was a journal I could read to understand them. So think about a journal. Think about documenting your life experiences. And most importantly, the hottest thing in the world is, while you're able, declutter. Once you start that decluttering process and you realize that all of those, like my Barbie dolls, right? All of the things that you treasure, your kids aren't going to care about. They're not going to care about at all. So all those things that you treasure, somebody else won't. So start the decluttering process. Donate, give away, throw away if you need. Obviously, check with your kids and make sure they don't really want it. But you know what? We have too much junk. We have too much crap. Get rid of it. As much as possible, because what's going to happen afterwards, if something happens tomorrow and you're not around, your kids are going to have to go through it. And then I'm thinking, oh man, I don't want my kids to have to go through this. I don't. I've been helping my mother go through my father's stuff, and I have a lot of my father's stuff because he worked in our home out in the garage. I have a lot of his stuff still to go through. And I think that brings an awareness, right, when you're doing it for a parent, that I don't want my kids to have to go through this. So get rid of that stuff. Get rid of that stuff while you're able, you know, and then spend your time. You know, once you've got that gone, you're going to feel like, oh, yeah, you're just going to have this big, huge sigh of relief. And then take a look around you and spend some time with your family, your loved ones, and just continue to create those memories. So I only had 10. He had 21. Some of his I did use with my own little twist on it. But and I'm so curious to see what Babs did. Take Control Beauty. If you're not connected with her, definitely I will link her information below. Go check it out. But at 78, she's an amazing woman. And I strive to be like her. She's, you know, I talk about kids having an infectious laugh. She does too. So anyways, I know this is super long and I hope you hung in there all the way to the end because I don't know what I would cut out of here, right? But yeah, so super long video. Thank you all so much. I will talk to you all later. Much love. Bye-bye. Oh, and don't forget, smash the like button, hit subscribe, and leave me a comment. Bye.